Amen. Thank you so much. I think about the incense that rises to the Lord, and I know you know this because you've heard me teach it, but your prayers are like an incense to the Lord, so is your worship. Matter of fact, Revelation tells us that He saves our prayers. Every single prayer that you have ever prayed is in a golden bowl before the throne of God that'll be poured out one day with the 24 elders. That is amazing to me when every time I think of a prayer that I've prayed, that God actually saves our prayers. Turn with me in your book, in your Bibles, to the book of Acts. We are at week 7. We are going to finish week 7 tonight. This drama is continuing to unfold as we go to the book of Acts. And as we talk about that book, it's pretty amazing when you think about it. The book of Acts is something that really has me riveted when I'm teaching it, has me riveted when I'm actually studying it. The church has been called to action. Obviously, the book of Acts is the start of it all. And if we are reading and studying the book of Acts, it's really about us. This is our history. This is our heritage. This is where it all started. Every single step that we see in the book of Acts is a step that God has planned. And even though we may not understand some of the steps, you're going to see Stephen die tonight. You're going to read about Stephen die, and it may be something we don't understand. Matter of fact, at the end, I'm going to ask some questions, not of you, but I'm just going to ask some rhetorical questions of why did it have to happen? So many times in our life, things happen and we don't understand why. But know this, God has a planned purpose for every single thing that goes on in our life. Somebody say amen. Whether we understand that or whether we don't, whether we agree with it or whether we don't. And you'll see that play out tonight. You'll see it flesh out in the life of Stephen. So the upper room tsunami, and that's what it was. It was a tsunami in the upper room. Some of you will be there in a couple months. The upper room tsunami is spreading across Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. It is unstoppable. This is the greatest movement that has ever hit the planet. And I hear about revivals all the time. There is no revival that could even put a candle to what was going here. This is an amazing movement and totally opposite of what the movement of Judaism was going for, because it was proclaiming one person who they knew was actually the Son of God. By the time we get to the end of Acts, this gospel will have swept over the entire known world, the Mediterranean basin, by the time we get to the end of Acts. As a matter of fact, get this, it'll happen in just 30 years. Now, I guarantee you that is a miracle in itself. Just in 30 years, the entire world will understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. It'll be preached that entire world, the Mediterranean world. So we know that the church is established at Jerusalem. We know that in Acts chapter 1 to chapter 7, which we'll finish tonight. In chapters 8 to chapters 12, the church is enlarged to Judea and Samaria. This is fulfilling what Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, to go ye into all the world and preach this gospel. He talked about Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. By the time we get to chapters 13 to 28, it'll be to the uttermost parts of the earth. If you look at the very end of that chart, you'll see that's AD 60. If you look over here, it's AD 30. 30 years, and the gospel goes to the entire known world at that time. That is unprecedented. Let me tell you why. There are no trains. There are no buses. There are no airplanes. And it's going to go by foot. It's going to go by word of mouth. This is a movement that could not be stopped. And I want you to see the pathos of it tonight. I want you to understand the magnitude of what happened. This is something that has literally taken over the pagan world. The pagan world had been established for 2,000 years. Nothing could take out that pagan world. And one man, by the way, you're going to meet him in a moment. Not tonight, but maybe next week you're going to meet him, should the Lord tarry. One man is going to carry that gospel. Just one man. Don't tell me that one person can't change their world. One man's going to do it, and he's going to dethrone Rome in his little lifetime that he has left. He's going to dethrone Rome. But before we get there, the church will continue to grow exponentially. We know that. As we watch this church growing, as we watch what's happening here, it will grow exponentially. Let me show you just a little bit of the church growth so you can see what's going on here. In Acts 2:41, 3,000 were added that day. You may remember when I told you about that. Acts 4:4, the disciples grew to 5,000. By the way, usually they're only counting men at this time. That's not counting women and children. Acts 5:14, more and more men and women. Acts 5:28 says, you have filled Jerusalem. That word filled means overpopulated. So obviously there's a weight that's going on here. The Jews and the Christians have a population type of equity at this time. In Acts 6:7, it says, the number of disciples increased rapidly, and large numbers numbers of priests were obedient. This is talking about priests from the Sanhedrin. These are talking about priests from the temple, the course of the temple. So we're watching it invade Judaism and change it from the outside and from the inside. When we get to Acts 8:4 next week, those scattered preached the word wherever they went, and then we'll continue to go on and tell you about what happened there. So we're watching this exponential advance of the gospel happening and people getting saved and joining the church, as it's now called. One of my most favorite quotes is from the French poet and novelist Victor Hugo. I remember quoting it in a message I gave a long time ago. He said this. He said, "There is nothing more powerful than an idea whose time has come." I love that quote. This is more than an idea. The gospel is much, much more than an idea. It was an explosive fact. So explosive that the powerful Jewish Sanhedrin was doing everything in its power to try and stop it. Now imagine. Imagine that you were in the lead and you were leading a nation. You were a religious leader and they came to you for everything they needed. Imagine that you got very, very wealthy on those people that came to you. Imagine that you had a system where people can come and give offerings to your temple and they give offerings to your church, and even if they had to do a Passover, they had to buy a sheep from you or doves, turtle doves from you. And imagine you weren't killing those things, but you're recycling them and selling them back. Imagine people coming from all over the known world and exchanging their money, and they have to come to the priests and the Sanhedrin and the Jewish leaders to do that. Imagine you being a leader and imagine watching that evaporate almost overnight. Imagine that start to go away within the course of a couple months. Imagine now you're saying where the monies you used to have are dwindling down to almost nothing. You are going to be incensed. You're going to try to stop it whatever way you can. Currently on your list of public enemies, public enemy number one is Stephen. He's passionate, he's charismatic, he's spirit-filled, he's tongue-talker, he's a miracle worker, and people are flocking to him. So they are looking at him to take him down. They need to make an example of someone. They need to stop the bleeding, literally, of their institutions and of the things that are happening around them. Accused of blasphemy, falsely accused, he's questioned at length. And his response is a powerful dissertation of Jewish history and of Jewish rebellion, capping his sermon off with three powerful lines pointed at the judgmental, rebellious leaders of the court. He says this, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart." Prior to this, he's not even talking about them. Now he points it at them. He says, and ears, "You do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted?" We read you this last week. "And they have slain them which showed before the coming of the just one, of whom you have been now the betrayers and murderers." So he is filling in the blanks here. He's saying our forefathers were talking about the Messiah. They were talking about Jesus, and you just murdered him, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. He says our forefathers have rebelled and you have joined them. They have killed the prophets. Does Stephen know what he's talking about? Well, I showed you last week how the prophets, some of the prophets died. He knows exactly what he's talking about. Isaiah was martyred by King Manasseh. By the way, the tradition says this. Isaiah, two types of traditions. It says, we know something has to be true along. It says that Isaiah was running away from the guards of King Manasseh and basically ran into a hollow tree, and they left him in there and they sawed the tree in half while he was in it, and blood gushed out of the tree. Another one says that they took him and put him in a hollow tree and they sawed him in half. Either way, that's exactly how they killed him. This is King Manasseh. He's a Jewish king. Jeremiah was martyred by stoning from the temple priests. Ezekiel was martyred by Jewish leaders in Chaldea. Micah was martyred by King Jehoram, an Israeli king. Amos tortured by Amaziah, which is a Jewish priest of Bethel, then martyred by Amaziah's son. And Zechariah was martyred by King Jehoahash at the temple altar, right inside the temple. He was martyred. So Stephen knows exactly what he's talking about. He says, your forefathers, you're reading Isaiah, you're studying Jeremiah, he says, you're studying Ezekiel, you believe in Micah, you believe in Amos, you believe in Zechariah, but all your forefathers killed them. And he says, and you did the exact same thing to the just one that came. Man, how many are getting it? So the result of his defense, if you will, which turned into an indictment of his listeners, is where we pick it up tonight. And tonight we go right here. In our outline following it, we're underlined. It's Acts chapter 7, verses 54 to 60. Ending chapter 7, it shows us the faith with which he died. And it's okay to have faith when you're living. But when you have faith when you're dying, that's real faith. Somebody say amen. It's all right to have faith when everything's going well, but when things are bad, that's when your faith is really tested. And boy, he's going to come out much, much tried and true. So as we finish out chapter 7 of Acts and read of Stephen, who is also, by the way, the church's first martyr, we are going to start with Acts chapter 7, verse 54. And it says this. When they heard these things, when he spoke those cutting things to them, they were cut to the heart and they gnashed on him with their teeth. I want to take those words apart for you tonight and let you know what's going on here. The Living Bible puts it like this. It says, the Jewish leaders were stung to fury by Stephen's accusation and ground their teeth in rage. Wow. The force of the Greek, we really don't get it in reading it in English. The force of the Greek wording here is that the members of the Sanhedrin wailed in erratic, wild, jeering shouts of anger and hostility. There was an angry mob atmosphere. And you can imagine, he says these couple lines and they start screaming at him and they start doing this. That's gnashing their teeth. The descriptive term, I'll show you a little bit more. Cut to the heart means they were convicted. It didn't mean that they were hurt. It meant that they were convicted. They felt the pain of what he was saying. The raw nerve had not only been touched, it had been cut to the core. The phrase gnashed him with their teeth means they ground their teeth at Stephen with a hissing sound. That's pretty, if you ever see something like, I've ever heard, how many of you have ever seen somebody get that mad? Well, I hope it wasn't you. But if you've seen somebody get that mad, they actually grind their teeth and they do what we see right here. The imagery is pretty powerful if you see it. If anybody is doing something like this at you, trust me, you either need to fight or flight because something's going to happen there. And so this is what they're doing. They're grinding their teeth and they're hissing at him. I mean, you can imagine now, what would you do if you had a group of men who had some power, who had you tried, and you're in front of them, and they start doing this, all of them, yelling at you and screaming at you and grinding their teeth and being angry, like a mob type of violence that was going on. So it means this, by the way, the imagery is pretty powerful. It denotes both anger and pain. It's interesting to me that if they don't change their hearts, this won't be the last time they gnash their teeth, if you know what I'm talking about. Listen to Jesus' words. Luke, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth when you shall see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God and you yourselves stressed out. He's speaking that to Pharisees, by the way, when Jesus is talking. And then he says this, and they shall come out from the east and from the west and from the north and from the south and sit down in the kingdom of God. He's actually talking about you and me today. He's saying that we're the ones that are going to replace the Jews who are persecuting Christ. Not Jews for all time, the ones specifically who are persecuting Christ. He says, they shall come and sit down in the kingdom of God. And behold, there are last which shall be first, and there are the first which shall be last. The Jews are the chosen lineage of God. But if they forget him, he won't forget them. But if they forget him, he will go to the next in line. We are adopted Jews. Somebody say amen. We are adopted Jews. So the same day there came certain Pharisees saying to him, get thee out and depart hence, for Herod will kill thee. I guarantee you that those same Pharisees were the ones that told Herod where Jesus was. And so he's telling them, he's saying there's going to be gnashing of teeth. And it's ironic to me that they're gnashing their teeth at Stephen. Here's another spot where it tells you about that. This is in Matthew chapter 8. And it says, and I say to you that many shall come from the east and the west. We're from the west, by the way. Shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. You and I are going to sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Man, I can't wait. Listen. But the children of the kingdom, the Jews, shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. He tells us in hell, which most people don't even want to talk about anymore, this is going to happen. There's going to be burning and gnashing of teeth. It's a conviction, it's a pain, and it's an anger. You know what I think one of the biggest torments in hell is going to be? The fact that people could have given their hearts to God. I think the knowledge of them being able to have done it and not done it is going to last with them for all of eternity and haunt them for all of eternity. Well, right now, go back to Acts. Notice how the message puts that as we go a little bit further. Let me show it to you. In Acts chapter 7, verse 55 and 56, it goes on. I'll give you the message in a moment. But he, Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven. Now, they're angry at him. They're gnashing their teeth. They're catcalling to him. They're saying everything they possibly can. They're jeering at him and saw the glory, and probably hitting him right now. There's temple guards around. They're probably beating him right now. And saw the glory of God. He's full of the Holy Ghost. He looks up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Man, I could preach a message just on that verse. Let me tell you why. When turmoil happens all around you, you're not supposed to look all around you. You're supposed to look up in heaven. You want to if you want any solace from someone, don't pick up your cell phone and call your neighbor. They're not going to help you. You got to look up to God. Come on, somebody say amen. I'm going to preach tonight, I promise you. And said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Stephen had a vision in the midst of his persecution. Man, we should not throw away persecution lightly. Persecution will get you to the closest to God you have ever been. So he is there for moments before his death, and he has a vision of Christ. He is wide awake, and he sees Christ standing at the right hand of God. By the way, it's a pretty interesting thing he says, because most of the times you hear in the scripture about Jesus with God's right hand, he's sitting. And so he's standing almost as if to receive Stephen as that first martyr. It's a powerful point in history. Notice how the message puts this. It says it this way. It says, at that point they went wild, a rioting mob of catcalls and whistles and invectives. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, hardly noticed. He only had eyes for God. Man, there's my message. I'm going to be preaching it tonight to you. He only had eyes for God, whom he saw in all his glory with Jesus standing at his side. He said, oh, I see heaven wide open and the Son of Man standing at God's side. So it's pretty amazing when you think it. He only had eyes for God. It's a message for us tonight. In the midst of persecution, he only had eyes for God. In the midst of trouble, he only had eyes for God. In the midst of hatred, he only had eyes for God. In the midst of turmoil, he only had eyes for God. In the midst of sudden death, he only had eyes for God. Man, I sense that the Lord is speaking to someone right now. I sense that someone came here tonight. I've sensed it all day. And there's some trouble brewing in your life. And maybe you're looking around all the circumstances that are around you. Let me tell you, if you get anything out of this tonight at all, get this out. You have to have eyes for God. You can only see God. The more you look at your trouble, the more the trouble is going to bother you. You got to stop looking at your trouble and you got to start looking for God. You got to have eyes for God. And I promise you that God will give you that same angelic appearance, that same angelic feeling that he gives, that peace that he gave Stephen in the midst of turmoil. Man, I'm telling you, I can preach, but I got to go on. It's a word for someone tonight. It's all, to only have eyes for God. So looking at the Sanhedrin's faces that day was not a pretty sight. It wasn't a pretty picture. But in comparison, and for Saul to observe, by the way, which he obviously never forgot. Remember, he dictated this account to Luke. This is Paul dictating this later on in his life. Was the radiant face of Stephen. So just imagine, just let me paint the picture for you. Imagine a mob violence. Imagine them ready to come up in arms and do something to Stephen. And imagine Stephen being totally calm and totally peaceful. You know, I've gone to the Colosseum many times in Rome, and last time I was there, there was an Italian guide, and they were guiding us, and they were showing us where the animals were cupped, and we've seen it before, and they were bringing them up, and they said, this is where they had naval battles in the main arena, and this is where they had naval battles, and they had ceremonies, and he went on and on, and I said, and they killed Christians. Oh, no, we have no proof that they killed Christians. I said, are you kidding me? I said, did you ever read some of the histories of your nation? They killed Christians. He said, well, we're not supposed to say that. I said, I don't care what you're supposed to say. They killed Christians here. That's what they did. They ate them. They had their wild animals eat Christians. It was a sport. And you know why it was a sport? Because when the Christians came out with their families, they had their arms open so that those animals can come and eat them. Nobody ever saw anything like it. They didn't cower down in fear. They accepted their death and they had peace on their face. Let me tell you, the historians, one after another, will talk about how those Christians were a sight. That's why people came to see them, because they were a sight. They were embracing the lions. They would hug the lions as they came, and they're tearing them apart, because they knew they were going to be with God, with Christ. That was the sport, because they had something inside them. Let me tell you something. The world just isn't going to give you that. Somebody say amen. His face was peaceful, full of restitude, resolute, and joyful. Stephen's face wasn't set against the grim faces of the Sanhedrin, but lifted up towards the face of the Lord. And the Sanhedrin's face were opposed to it. It was just looking straight at him in anger and angst. And Stephen's face was shining, because he never took his eyes off the face of the Lord. Man, we can learn so much for living our lives today if we just let that sink in. If we just let that image sink into our minds. Think of the world around you. A great deal of anger, is there not? Unsettledness, angst, war. You know, I was watching the news the other day, and every now and then, just to torture myself, I turn on CNN. Just to torture myself. And I turn it on, and they're angry. They're angry. They talk about Trump and they're angry. These are newscasters. And you can see the anger coming out. I listen to NPR every now and then, which is another angry type of thing. And they're angry. Every time they talk about him, they're angry. You can see the anger. They're so prejudiced with it. And I watch our world. Our world is angry about so many things. You can look at our world. You can see it all over our world. The rage and the anger is all around. Faces, the outrage, the nations, the leaders, people, generations. You can see it everywhere. You can go to a store sometimes and watch somebody cut somebody off in a parking spot and watch the anger that comes out of their faces. It's absolutely unbelievable. What should our faces look like with a backdrop of worldly anger? What should we be looking like? What should we look like? Bright, shining, glowing, peaceful, radiant with the joy of the Lord. Man, that takes determination. It takes discipline to do that. It takes messages like this one tonight. So to remind you that your face sometimes is the only thing that angry world sees. And if that angry world sees that your face, they should be convicted just by your face. In what you are, especially when there's things that should cause the normal person to be angry. Man, how many are getting convicted tonight? In the midst of daily struggles, David said this in Psalm 16. He said, I keep my eyes always on the Lord, with Him at my right hand. And what else does he say? I will not be shaken. So David says, and David had his share of problems. He says, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. I don't keep it at Saul who's throwing spears at me. I don't keep it at Absalom who stole my kingdom. I don't keep my eyes on the troubles I have. I don't keep it on the Philistines. I keep it always on the Lord. So we see this as a mantra for us tonight. Back to Acts. Then the rage of the Sanhedrin, pent up so long, finally lets loose in all of its fury on Stephen. In Acts chapter 7, we read of it. It says this. Then they cried out with a loud voice, megaphonos. That's the two Greek words. I just thought of it now. I remember reading it many times ago. We get our word megaphone from it. They cried out with a megaphonos and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. Now, I'm going to tell you what first century stoning was. Sometimes we just read past these words and we just think people are throwing stones at someone. That's not what first century stoning was. They had several different types of capital punishment, as I told you. Beheading, they actually had, which was the most humane part of capital punishment. They had hanging on a tree, which Jesus did, which was pretty bad. And then they had stoning, which was probably equivalent to crucifixion, believe it or not. Crucifixion lasted a little longer, was a little more torturous, but stoning was very torturous. Listen, it says, they cast him out of the city and stoned him, and the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. Now, I want you to hear that, because this is setting you up. Luke is taking you somewhere. He's showing you something. Stephen is that transition, and he's bringing you somewhere. It was as if some prearranged signal, and they all rushed in on Stephen. Mob violence, instigated and initiated by a young Pharisee named Saul. Saul was the one that arrested him. Saul was the one that probably, we don't know for sure, but probably paid for people to lie about him and to bring him in. Saul was on a mission. He was a young Pharisee, probably 30, 31 years old. He's looking to make his mark. He's been given instructions that he can go and herald down any Christians he wants and bring him in, because their whole society is crumbling around them. And he's given charge to do that. He seeks out Stephen. I'm just repeating what I told you in a previous chapter. He went to the synagogue of the freedmen. Remember, we talked about that. They were Greek Jews, not ones that lived there. Paul was from Antioch, Cilicia. Paul was part of that synagogue. Stephen was not from a local either. Stephen was from the Greek islands. So he went there to that synagogue in Jerusalem and sought out the foreign Jews, and he knew Stephen would be there. He laid a trap for him. He arrested him. These are previous studies. And he brings him before the Sanhedrin. Now please note, it was no easy task to arrange a death sentence and assure an execution and not become directly involved. According to Jewish tradition, Saul, his accuser, he's the one that brought him before the Sanhedrin, should have thrown the first stone. That's one of the reasons why Jesus said, who will cast the first stone? The reason why is because the one who cast the first stone has the proof that this person is guilty. So if you brought him to the Sanhedrin, you'll learn a little bit about the Eastern culture. If you brought him to the Sanhedrin and you were the one that brought him, like Saul did, it's expected of you to cast the first stone, because you are the one that have initiated it. Saul is not going to cast the stone, which tells me a couple things as I read between the lines. Tells me that this man is a persuader. this man can get people to do things for him and him sit by the side and watch it. This man is extremely intelligent, he's extremely cunning, and he knows exactly what he's doing. You'll notice that it says they laid their clothes down at his feet. He didn't take up any stones, which is very, very unusual. Saul the accuser should have been the one casting the first stone, but Saul was no ordinary man. His brilliance, fired by his hatred, worked it all out. Also note here that those who killed Stephen laid down their coats at Saul's feet. Now, just notice this. What does that mean? Well, it means this. How many here tonight have ever had a cat or you have a cat? Have you ever let your cat outside? Has your cat ever killed a mole? What's the first thing that cat does when it kills a mole? It brings it straight to your feet, to your doorstep. Why does it do that? It's pride. Cats want you to know, look what I've done for you. And so, by the way, cats are a killing machine. They are the most accurate killers on all the planet. They kill 99.9% of everything they chase. It's unheard of. And so a lion, for example, which is a big cat, but a lion will only kill 50% of the things it chases. But a house cat will kill 99.9%. But what they'll do if they kill a small animal, they'll bring it to your feet, they'll bring it to your doorstep, and they'll leave it there. This is exactly what these people are doing. Why are they doing it that way? They want Saul to be proud of them. They want them to know that we're carrying out what you started. And so it gives you a little bit more understanding of the story when you see it fleshed out. So they're bringing it to him. Now, they're actually saying, look what we're doing for you. Are you pleased with what we're doing for you? Later, at the end of his life, look what Paul said. He said this in Acts 27:20. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consented unto his death and kept the raiment of them that slew him. So Paul now, at the end of his life, is saying, yes, I was the one standing by. It had to hurt him his entire life. After Stephen was beaten by the Jews, they were in a frenzy. They had to finish what they had started. Since no blood could be spilled in the temple precincts, you would defile it, they had to drag the dazed and beaten Stephen outside the city wall for one of the most painful and prolonged methods of execution imaginable. Now, by the way, he would not have been placed in front of them. I'm going to show you some pictures from some master painters in the 1500s, and they threw stones at him. That's not the way it happened. Even though you'll see Jesus talking about the woman being stoned, I promise you, it's not any picture you've ever seen of that woman the way she was with her there, Jesus here, and the mob here. I promise you that's not the way it happened. Because what they did in stoning is they did this. They took the accused out, they threw him over the wall, or they threw him over a hill, and they threw him into a pit. Remember Jesus was when he was in Nazareth, and they brought him to the edge of the cliff? Remember that? They were going to stone him. They were going to throw him off the cliff, which he wouldn't have died from. They would have had injuries. He wouldn't have been able to run away. And then they would have stoned him from down. From up here, they would have stoned down on him. So when I tell you this, this is what they did with Stephen. They took him outside the Temple Mount. Outside. And by the way, the Temple Mount at that time is just like it was today. Almost every place around that wall dropped straight off. They would have found a spot where there was some type of depression. They would have thrown him off. He would have broken legs. His legs would have been broken. He could have broken arm, and he's going to be crippled. He's going to be wounded. And then at that moment, they'll start pelting him with stones. Now, unless they hit a kill shot, he's going to be stoned for a long time. It's a prolonged agony. And so I want you to see it tonight. I know it's gruesome, but I want you to see it tonight. So he would have been pushed over the wall into a pit from which there was no escape from the hurling stones. These are the way the artists do it. Caravaggio shows it like that. That is not accurate. They are not going to be that close to him at all. Here's another one that Caravaggio also did, this one. That's not going to happen either. Then you have this one from Raphael. That's not the way it happened. Although they have him outside the city walls, that's not going to happen that way. Or you'd have this one from another artist that shows them stoning. That's not going to happen. More likely, it would be something like this with more of a deeper depression and no one on the bottom, but everybody up on top. So if this artist took everybody and put them on top, made that wall longer and deeper and higher, and had a depression on the bottom, that's the way they would have stoned him. And the same way they've done almost everyone when they stone him. Unlike those master paintings, Stephen would not be stoned at close range, but stone hurled down upon him from above. Now, if you know anything about the law of gravity, you'll know that all you have to do when you're above someone is pick something up very, very heavy, and you can throw it, just let it drop. You can't throw something that heavy at somebody vertically. So the stones that come out of him are not these little stones. These are massive pieces of stones. They're coming down on him. The crowd that day was not as accurate or precise in aim as an execution squad. You see, historians tell us that the Jews actually had execution squads, men who were capable of doing this. And they would do it and they were on command and on order. But this is an angry crowd. They have no such assemblage of people. Probably the fateful death blow was a long time in coming. They'd have to hit him in the head. It's a long time in coming. And legalistic Saul stood by to make sure that everything measured up to the code that is mentioned in Leviticus for stoning someone who blasphemed. Leviticus says this, "And he that blasphemes the name of the Lord, he shall surely be put to death. And all the congregation shall certainly stone him, as well as the stranger, and he that is born in the land, when he blasphemes the name of the Lord, shall be put to death." They are fulfilling the law as they see it. Luke tells us, they stripped their outer garments and laid them at Saul's feet. And he watched as the first stones plummeted down on Stephen's body, and then his face. How could it be that that face was still radiant and glowing? How in the world could that be? The Bible is explicit. It says that he had the face of an angel. It was radiant. It was glowing. He wasn't even looking. And when it says he looked up, he looked past them. Think about it. He's looking up at the stones coming down him and upon him, and he's looking past the stones and them, and he sees God. Man, how many understand Stephen a little bit better today? You'll never see Stephen the same again. Who was this man anyway? Who was Stephen? What was it that gave him this kind of courage? Look at Acts 7, 59 and 60. "And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, 'Lord Jesus, receive my spirit.' And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, 'Lord, lay not this sin to their charge.' And when he had said this, he fell asleep." He died. So that kneeling down is almost simultaneously when he gets thrown off that cliff. He gets back and he kneels down. So he obviously has made his way up, and then he comes back down, and the stone's still coming at him. While he's doing that, he sees the heavens open, and then he forgives them as they're doing it. Look how the message puts it. "As the rocks rained down, Stephen prayed, 'Master Jesus, take my life.' Then he knelt down, praying loud enough for everyone to hear." Megaphonos. "Master, don't blame them for this sin." His last words, then he died. I'm telling you, it's a case study in last words. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he fell on his knees and cried out, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he fell asleep. Those are last words. I've been at the bedsides of a lot of people who died, and I've seen some people say some pretty nasty last words. I've seen some people have radiant faces like Stephen, and you knew that they had connected somewhere. And I've seen people just be able to call out to God. But when you see Stephen's last words, it has to give you a moment of inspiration to know that this man is living his life. And by the way, Stephen is not an old person here. It's estimated, are you ready for it? It's estimated that Stephen's about 20 to 21 years old. He's a young man. He's a very young man. He's just starting out. He's just starting out, and he's so zealous and so fired up for God. Stephen's prayer, as the death blow hit, revealed to Saul, whom the martyr believed was his sustaining power. Saul heard him say that. A chill must have passed through Saul's heart as he heard the name he had grown to hate so passionately. "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he prayed forgiveness for the ones putting him to death, with the same peaceful face in death as well as when he was living. I mean, I'm amazed at Stephen, to be honest with you. I'm amazed at this life, this young life, and what it's done. I can't help but think that for that face would haunt Saul until he met the one whose love and power it reflected. But in the meantime, his hatred was fueled with fear, and it made him more determined than ever and more dangerous. Okay, now before we leave this chapter tonight, and before I close, we need to ask some pertinent questions, because I think you need to ask questions at this point. Here we go. You ready? What did Stephen's death do to the church? Well, it raised some profound questions. What was the Lord doing? Why did he allow this man to die? Listen, how could he allow this to happen to one of so faithful as Stephen? And maybe you want to throw in their young, or maybe you want to throw in their charismatic, or maybe you want to throw in their life-changing. Everybody that came around him, he performed miracles. This man was doing something that obviously nobody else in the church was doing other than the apostles. He was a pivotal part of that young church. He was making disciples. People were coming to him. They were listening to him. He had an enigma. They had an enigma thinking about him. Well, how could he do all this? How could he bring so many people to him? Why didn't God stop it? Have you ever asked God why he didn't stop something that was pretty bad going on? Listen, Stephen was at the height of his power as a witness. Why snuff out so bright a flame? If you and I were God, we would love to have someone like Stephen on our side. Stephen can change hearts of thousands of people. Why would you let him die? Did God have the power not to let him die? Of course he did. So then why did God allow him to die? All right, we will see you next week about... We've all asked those questions before, haven't we? Think of your own life. About tragedies that have hit our lives, haven't we? Haven't every single one of us said that? Why did this have to happen to me, God? Why didn't you stop this, God? Why did this have to go on, God? Why did I have to go through this, God? What are you trying to do here, God? Well, the questions about Stephen can only be answered by the reflection of history. And let me give you a little secret of life. You will never understand the things that happen, some of the things that happen in your life while you're going through them. Ever. You have to have a distance from it so you can understand it. Only with a distance. I've watched people go through some pretty hard stuff. I've gone through some pretty hard stuff myself. And let me tell you something, it's only from a distance that I understand the perspective. That's why you have to have the faith during it, because God's given you faith to get out of it and to stand from it and say, oh, that's what happened. Maybe you won't even realize why it is. Maybe God will never reveal why he's done it to you. God never comes and gives a prophet to the church at this time and says, this is why I did it, but I'm going to tell you I know why he did it. I know exactly why God did it. And I'll promise you, probably no one there in that young church knew it. The Lord was not finished. Just think about it for a moment. Through Stephen's death, the sect of Judaism that was called the church was forced to flee Jerusalem. Look, Acts 8:1. And Saul was consenting unto his death, and at that time there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the region of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Did anybody see it? Without Stephen dying, the commission for Jesus saying, go into all the world, into Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and all the world, and preach my gospel, would not have happened. The persecution came, Stephen died, and the church, which is overpowering, it says that they were more powerful in Jerusalem than the people that were in Jerusalem, was overpowering the numbers in Jerusalem. We have stayed there and overpowered them, but that wouldn't have ever got them out of Jerusalem. The death of Stephen and the persecution coming to the church scattered them like to the wind, and they started to take this word, and they went everywhere with it. There is a saying... He said, you shall be witnesses, remember, to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. He didn't say, you will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and overtake Jerusalem. That's what they were doing. So how did he get them out of there? Well, the Christians were scattered, and their faith was scattered with them. They were like this. It reminds me of this, seeds of a dandelion. One of my granddaughters was over the other day, and she likes to pick flowers. She does not know that's a weed. So she likes to pick flowers, and she was picking the flowers, and she picked it up. Every time she'd pick one of these up, they were ripe. Every time she'd pick one up, all the flower would go away. It was just gone. She'd pick it up, she'd be real happy. She'd get it. It was white. She'd get it, and then by the time she got it up here, all the seeds were gone. It was like, and she'd almost cry. She'd pick another one up, and she'd do the same thing. So I told her we had to sit down. We had to stoop down, and we stooped down. I said, now listen, this is a flower that has seeds on it. You're not seeing the flower, you're seeing the seeds. All these little things are seeds. And the wind, you can breathe, and all those seeds will scatter this flower. And then I told her something that's kind of true. I said, and when we come back next year, there won't be just one, but there'll be hundreds over here. And it is the truth. Of course, I'm not sure I'll go to that same spot next year, but it is the truth. You know what someone said? Tertullian, a church father, said this. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. What happened was Stephen's blood allowed the church to spread. Now, you and I would not think of that as a tragedy, because we think of a tragedy. But God knew with this blood that the whole church was going to spread over the whole Mediterranean basin. And that's exactly what happened. They spread out like that, like the wind, the Holy Spirit wind blowing that dandelion. He blew them to the four corners of the known world. The Christians were scattered and their faith went with them. Like the seeds of a dandelion, the wind of the Holy Spirit was sowing them to all parts of the known world. They would have never have left Jerusalem without this persecution and the punishment inflicted upon them. The death of Stephen ignited a fire of hatred from the Jewish leaders, and that exploded in a religious fury. They had to leave. And their exodus planted the seeds of faith which would germinate. Listen to this one. Their seeds of faith would go back. They'd go back to synagogues all over the world. That's where they came from, a lot of them. and they'd speak this message. A lot of times they'd be rejected until a man later on would come in some of those cities where the synagogues were, and he'd visit those cities and he'd start churches. He'd germinate the seed. That man was Saul, who became Paul. He would water what they already brought back. And that's why the churches started to grow. It was because Stephen's blood scattered the church with the persecution. They went back to their synagogues. Some of them rejected, didn't know what to do. But Paul, raised up by God, just a couple years later, would go back and travel all over those cities. And every place he would go, he would plant a church. Let me tell you what he'd do. He'd find faithful in that area. There were probably people who had heard this gospel because of the scattering. How many of you have seen God's hands in this? Listen, the hand of God knows a whole lot more than you know. The mind of God knows a whole lot more. I don't know why we go through tragedies. I don't know why things happen, but I know this. At the perspective of history, when I stand back, I can see fully the plan of God without any error, and I can see what's going on. So the saying was very, very true. The blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Stephen had lived a short life, again, 20, 21, 22 maybe, but he accomplished his purpose. He was the simple turning point and the single turning point that would gnaw at Saul and that would put the church to flight and that would provide the catalyst to the overthrow of a pagan world that lasted for 2,000 years up until that point. But in closing, I want to revisit Acts chapter 7, verse 56 from the message. When Stephen, rushed by an angry mob, said, "I only have eyes for God." Man, I want that to be my prayer tonight. In the midst of a world on the edge of disaster, I only want to have eyes for God. In the middle of an impending financial collapse in our nation, I only want to have eyes for God. In the late night hours of an emergency room visit, I only want to have eyes for God. Listen, at the bed of a dying saint, I only want to have eyes for God. When trouble comes in my life, I only want to have eyes for God. When pain endures, I only want to have eyes for God. I want it to be our prayer tonight. Fix my eyes upon you, O God. Matter of fact, I really believe that that's exactly what we need to do, is to fix our eyes on Christ tonight. Fix our eyes on God. That's where our focus has to be, especially at this point in time. Oswald Chambers said this. He said, "We have to pray with our eyes on God, not on the difficulties." And so if you're going through a difficulty tonight, please take this as a message directly to you. I think that this is what we need to see. If God is not our primary focus, then everything else will soon get out of focus. We have to focus on God. You know, as Good Friday is coming tomorrow, our eyes need to be pointed towards that. And we need to really understand that Jesus died for us. It's something simple, something parochial. You know, when I was Catholic and I was going to Catholic church, Holy Week was a big thing for us. And I was an altar boy, and then I was not an altar boy, but I was forced to go to church, and I went because I was in fear of having a mortal sin and dying with all my soul until I got to a point where I didn't care. But when I would go there on Fridays when I was a young boy, my mother would put us in our room from 12 o'clock till 3 o'clock, and we couldn't do a thing. You couldn't do anything. You had to just sit there, and you had to think about Jesus being on the cross at that moment. I still remember it. I wish I could have done that the rest of my life because it made me focus. But let me just tell you this. Friday came, but Sunday was coming. Amen. Sunday was on the way. And I know that Sunday is the thing that makes me focus on Christ tonight. Acts 8, verse 2 and 3 says this, "And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him." Would you bow your heads with me tonight? Again, I've had a burden all day and all yesterday when I started to prepare this message for someone, maybe many people, maybe it's somebody on YouTube, that you're really going through something. I can't force you to put your face towards God. I can't take away a trouble or a tragedy. Matter of fact, if it was you and I, and we knew that Stephen would be stoned, you may have wanted to stop him from being stoned. But let me just tell you this. God allowed him to be stoned because he knew that that church had a spread. Without Stephen's death, you and I wouldn't be here tonight. Without Stephen's death, the church would not have scattered. There would have been no one for Paul to germinate seeds of churches when he went on his three missionary journeys. And the Gentiles would have stayed in their paganism. And Christianity would only have been a sect of Judaism. Maybe it would have even faded out, staying in a local area. But because someone was willing to die, 20 years old, come on. We talk about people having their life in front of them. 20, 21 years old, he died with one single... He was born to die young. He was born to lay down his life. He was born to be the first martyr that the church on his blood would grow. Jesus already did it for all of us. He shed his blood so that we can have salvation. Many, many men and women have shed their blood down through the years so that you and I can continue to grow in Christ. So the church can grow in China and in Thailand and Laos and Cambodia and in South Africa. And yes, even in America at times. So tonight, there's a verse of scripture I'm reminded of. It says, you've not resisted unto blood. I love that one. It means that there's more in you. God has more in you. If you're going through a struggle, the reason why you're going through a struggle is God trusts you with that struggle. He trusts you that you can go through it, that you can endure, and you can have him on your side. So tonight I'm going to ask you to stand with me if you would. And I want to close in prayer tonight. Father, I thank you tonight for whoever you're speaking to. Maybe it's all of us. Whenever we have a struggle, let us remember, Lord God, that we must keep our eyes on you, that we have to fix our eyes on you. We only want to have eyes for you, God. Whether it's a struggle in our families, whether it's a small struggle or a large one or a medium, a manifold struggle, you have a manifold answer for. And I pray tonight, Lord God, if anyone is struggling, Lord, if anyone's going through something tonight, that the words would encourage them tonight. Not just the words of Stephen and the word of Acts, Lord God, but the words that you've spoken to us, that we could trust you, Lord God. We could fix our eyes on you. We could trust you. It's the principle all over your life. When Peter was in a storm, as long as he kept his eyes on you, he didn't sink when he came out of that boat. As long as he fixed his eyes on you. Help us tonight, Lord God, not to look at the external circumstances in our lives that are causing us pain and trouble, but help us to look at you, Lord God. Give us that radiant smile, Lord. Bless us, Lord. We're thankful for Resurrection Sunday, Lord God. May we celebrate as soon as we get up, realizing that you are risen, Lord God. You are risen indeed. Bless us now, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord.